So let's start with this example program, which, given an array A, computes the sum of all of its elements. That sum will be returned in this value s. This operation is actually an example of a pattern called a reduction. Now let's suppose we only care about the cost of addition and the cost of array access. That is, let's assume we can ignore the cost of all these other operations, like indexing operations, branches, and so on. Here's how the DAG for this computation might unfold. Let's start with iteration 1, and we need to load a sub 1 and then perform the addition. So in the DAG, there would be a node for a sub 1 and a node for the addition. And there would also be a dependence edge since the addition can't start until the load is complete. Now, what about the second iteration? We'll repeat the process, so there'll be a node for a sub 2 and a corresponding addition. Now, in this case, there will be two dependence edges, one from a sub 2 to the plus, and the other one from the other plus. Now, technically, there's another dependence, which goes from this plus to this load. So why is that? The reason is that the code is being executed sequentially, so there's actually what's called a control dependence between executions of the body of the for loop. That is, this statement at i equals 2 can't execute until this statement at i equals 1 has completed. Now, for now, we're going to ignore these control dependences. So if we ignore the control dependences and we continue this process, then you'll get a DAG that looks something like this. Now, suppose I give you a PRAM with P processors. How long will it take the PRAM to execute this DAG? Let's call that time T sub P of n. Now, notice that the loads have no input dependences. They're all ready to go. So you could take them as a group, assign them to the P processors, and execute them in batch. So in our cost model, that would take ceiling of n divided by p units of time. That is, there are n loads, which we divide among the p processors. Each load takes one unit of time. And since we're dealing with integers, we need this ceiling. So what about the additions? These additions have dependencies between them. So it looks like I can't ever execute a given addition until I've executed the previous addition. And it doesn't matter how many processors you have, you've got to execute these additions one at a time. Therefore, you'll need at least n units of time to complete all of the additions. Now, both of these conditions have to be true, so we can write this in a more compact form. Now, p is always at least 1, since presumably you're not going to run on a machine with no processors. So that means the ceiling of n over p is always going to be less than just plain old n. So we can simplify the time. So what we just showed is exactly what we expected, which is that a sequential reduction will take n units of time on a PRAM.